Okay, so now we have two vectors of length 1 that are orthogonal to each other that span the same space as a0 and a1 did. What we now want to do is compute a third vector. Let's go and look at the animation first, and then let's look at the math. Now the picture gets a little bit more complicated. Let's rotate through it. Let's start right here. We started with vector a0, the thin black arrow. We normalized that to be of length 1, that became our vector q0. We then took our vector a1 and we computed the component in the direction of q0, that's this right here, the inner product of q0 with a1 times q0. If we then take that dashed vector and subtract it off of a1, we end up with a vector perpendicular to the component in the direction of q0. If we then take that vector and normalize it to be of length 1 and view it as rooted at the origin, we end up with our vector q1. The q1 here is a little hard to see because it's behind our blue vector. And at that point, we have two vectors that span the same space as do a0 and a1, except that they are mutually orthonormal. If you now rotate this picture some more, and rotate it into this position right here, then what we see here is that a2 is definitely not in the plane spanned by q0 and q1. We can compute the projection of a2 onto the space spanned by q0 and q1 by creating a matrix, q super 2 here, that has as its columns the vectors q0 and q1. And then this was the formula for the projection onto the space spanned by these two orthonormal columns. If we take that dashed vector that we end up with and we subtract it from a2, we end up with the component of a2 perpendicular to the projection onto the space spanned by q0 and q1. That vector is then perpendicular to both q0 and q1. If we normalize that to have length 1 and view it as being rooted at the origin, then we end up with three vectors that are mutually orthonormal that together span the same space as do a0, a1, and a2. Okay, so what did you just observe? We observed that the blue plane in the animation was really the column space of the matrix that has columns q0, q1, and we call that q super 2. And those are given right here. We computed those earlier. What do we want to do? We want to project a2 onto the column space of q2. The formula for that is given right here. And then we want to subtract out that component, leaving us with the component that is orthogonal to both q0 and q1, and therefore the space spanned by the vectors q0 and q1. We again want to do this in two steps. The first is to recognize that we can compute scalars rho 02 and rho 12 as the inner product of q0 with a1 and the inner product of q1 with a1, which, by the way, we can think of as the matrix q2 transposed times the vector a1. And then what you want to do is you want to take the linear combinations of those vectors and subtract them off of a2. Now notice that we can also write that as a2 minus the component in the direction of q0 minus the component in the direction of q1. Which is also given right here. Remember, this was the formula for the component of a2 in the direction of vector q1. So you can either think of this as computing the component of a2 perpendicular to the column space of q2, or you can think of this as taking vector a2 subtracting out the component in the direction of q0, and then subtracting out the component in the direction of q1, that leaves you with the component of a2 that's orthogonal to both q0 and q1. If we do this for our concrete example, we have to take the inner products of q0 with a2, the inner product of q1 with a2, that leaves us with these scalars right here. And then if we take a2 and we subtract out the component in the direction of q0 and the component in the direction of q1, we're left with this vector right here, if I did everything right. And that's the that's the component of a2 orthogonal to both q0 and q1. We still need to take that vector and make it of length 1. So how do we do that? We take a2 perp and we divide by its length to come up with our new vector q2. And again, we do that in two steps. We first compute its length as the scalar rho 2,2, and then we divide a2 perp by rho 2,2. And we're going to see that that's going to give us a very nice characterization of this whole process later on. If we do this for our concrete example, we would have to compute the length of this, and that's just nasty. So I'm not going to do that. And if we then computed the length of that, then we could compute our vector q2. This process, where you repeatedly subtract off components in various directions that you have already computed, and then normalize the resulting vector, is called the Gram-Schmidt process. To compute q0, what do? You take a0 and you simply normalize it to have length 1. To compute q1, you take a1 and you compute the component orthogonal to q0, and then you normalize it to be of length 1. To compute q2, you compute the component orthogonal to q0 and q1, and then you normalize it. And if you wanted to compute q3, q4, q5, you simply keep going that way.